Recorded Books and One-Click Digital present An Elegant Solution by Paul Robertson, narrated by Jonathan Todd Ross. This story opens with the words, Eternal, Immortal, Invisible. And now, An Elegant Solution.
Chapter 1. The Ash Gate. Of dust is man made, and to dust man returns. So I sat, watching for the dust of men returning. I was on a hillside above Basel. My master Johann had me on an errand to watch for the return of his sons from Italy. It was late on a spring day. The sky was exactly blue, cut at the edge of the world by sharp white mountains. The fields were perfect green, engraved by the Rhine. And finally, around the side of my hill was an airy indistinctness. Dust. That was my signal, but I waited to be sure that it was dust raised by the coach from Bern. Once I saw the coach, drawn by four horses, I ran down the hill toward the city. I loved to run. I was first by minutes to the gate at the city wall. The coach wouldn't stop there. It was bound for an inn and stable inside. I waited there anyway. The gate was the ash gate, and was only passed with burning. Ashes were the symbol of renunciation. The passage of any gate was renouncing one side to enter the other. Ashes to ashes, and dust to dust, the coach came into view. The road passed over the moat on a causeway, and through an arch beneath a high, narrow stronghold. The coachman had his horses at a fast pace. I knew the man. He'd been driving the route for centuries. He waved to me. Then his coach, like an arrow on the straight road, shot over the bridge and pierced the gate. I followed through it. Immediately inside, the ash street was hedged with houses, in unyielding and uninterrupted lines. Always in Basel, the doors would be closed and the windows curtained. That afternoon, the street was empty and the coach hardly slowed. I was just as quick and kept with it. The street soon ended in another moat and wall and gate. This was the inner wall and the old city, and a short distance inside was the coach's destination and destiny. I reached the tavern as it did. There was a large public market square here, one of the few open spaces in Basel where its people would be found outside their homes. The inn waited on one side, and across from it stood the blunt face of an ancient church, the largest in Basel, even bulkier than the cathedral. The tavern was the Boot and Thorn. Its opposite was called the Barefoot Church. The coach halted. Knipper, the coachman, dropped nimbly from his box to the cobblestones as a lout from the inn was already scrambling upward toward the luggage. From the beginning, Knipper had driven that coach. He brought Erasmus to Basel and Ecolampadius and the Reformation. He brought Holbein and Paracelsus and the Renaissance. Knipper took Charlemagne through to Rome. Caesar, conquering the Gauls, crossed the Alps with Knipper, and Hannibal crossed the other way with his elephants in the luggage rack. And Knipper's horses, I knew, were named by Adam.
"I know who you're for," he bellowed to me.
He was a boisterous and cantankerous man, quick to answer, agile, and a dead shot with his pistols. A coach driver had to be all those.
"They're in there, safe and sound."
His hair was short and all white, though it would shine like silver in the sun, and he had no beard. "Their father's wanting them," I said.
"As I value my life, I won't keep that man waiting,"
Knipper answered in a suddenly low voice, and then back louder,
"So let's get them out."
He gave the handle a twist and the door a wrench and opened it onto a black cave. From that shadow, the passengers emerged. The first was a tiny old woman who descended the step with her bonnet bobbing like a pecking bird. The next was a wide man who swayed on his small feet like a swinging sack of wool. I let them both pass. Then a shoe buckle and shoe and stocking-legged were planted on the step, and a three-cornered hat and white wig bowed low beneath the low door, and I knew I had my man. The whole accordion unfolded. "Daniel," I said. I hadn't seen him in the 2 years since he'd fled. He was dressed beyond Sir Basil's tastes in a wine silk coat and ruffled collar. Italy and aging had done their work on him.
"Leonhard," he answered,
and I knew from his smile that his cheerfulness was unchanged. He shook my hand vigorously.
"Well met."
He'd hardly put himself on solid ground when another hat and another wig followed. But his brother Nikolaus was a very different fish. Brothers contrast as bells do, near the same and discordant the more alike they are. Daniel and Nikolaus both had their father's large, brooding eyes in their mother's long and narrow face. Daniel achieved this well, fixing the world with the stare of a philosophic hawk. In Nikolaus, the effect was perplexing, something like a furious sheep. At the age of 30, Nikolaus had the gentle rounding of affluence, more than the still stick-like Daniel, and taller. Daniel was just 25, 7 years my senior. In temperament, the common inheritance from their father was their eternal curiosity, and from their mother, a piercing perception. But two other traits from their parents were odd-crossed. Daniel thrived on conversation, having his mother's love of talking and his father's care at hearing. Nikolaus had the reverse, his father's dislike of speaking and his mother's disdain for listening. The parents had been compatible, the brothers a torture to each other. They still had a strong fraternal fondness, though. A common enemy had made them allies.
"Blasted long ride," Nikolaus said.
But Daniel was shaking my hand eagerly.
"How have you weathered these 2 years?"
"Very well," I answered. "And the brute?" he asked. And I knew his aversion to his father was also unchanged. Master Johann was the most opposite among mankind of an unthinking animal. And Daniel, among mankind, most knew that. "As well as ever."
"I feared as much. But he won't live forever, will he? He'll have to die sometime."
"We all will," Nikolaus said. "But who'll carry the baggage?"
"That's the lot of the living, to carry what's left behind by the dead," Daniel said.
Yet Nikolaus, who was lean with words, would use one sentence to say more than one thing. He'd meant the luggage from the coach. "The boy's hired to bring it to the house," I said. "And the driver, too." Knipper himself was already unloading the first bags, and Villy, the hulking tavern lout, was bringing out a cart. "We're to go on right away."
"We're to go right away? Then I'll stop right away. Join me in the Boot and Thorn for a cup, Leonhard."
"Not I." The innkeeper had come out to watch us, and he and the coachman had whispered words. That man was earth and fire to Knipper's wind and fire, and I'd seen many sparks between them. Then Knipper took the first bags into his hands.
"Perhaps in the church for a kneel, then," Daniel said to me. "That's what you'd rather?"
"I'd rather get you to the master's house."
"And be at it," Nicholas growled.
The first street toward Master Johann's house from the square was the Contention Alley, and it was well named for what it was leading us to. I had a quick sight of Knipper turning the corner ahead of us, while the brothers were looking back at Villy tugging heavy trunks onto the cart. Then we were off, and the march to Master Johann's house was short and sharp. In the minute of walking, I asked Daniel about Italy. It was really to hear about himself, and my ears were quickly filled. Daniel had been my close friend in the first lonely years I was in Basel away from my own parents. He and his brothers had been brothers to me, and Daniel the most. I'd grieved when he left. I'd grieved for why he had had to leave. I'd worried he would never return. Nikolaus was silent, of course. He hadn't lived in Basel in the years I'd been here, but for the last two that Daniel had been away, Nikolaus had lived in Bern and been a frequent visitor to his father's house. When I did get him to talk, he was worth listening to, and had been kind to me in his own way. Two quick streets brought us to the second of Basel's open spaces. The bare Münster Square was much different from the market square of bare feet. The brick Münster, Basel's cathedral, was more daunting than the old white church, taller and sharper. The plaza was less square than rectangular and too holy for the sellers and money changers. Its houses were larger and fewer, and the largest and fewest was my master's. Daniel must have had painful memories to see it. But as we came into that square, and in sight of that house, I knew Nikolaus and even Daniel felt that delight, universal to men, of homecoming. I knew it well from the occasions I saw my own father's house. I considered the house of Master Johann to have been at least as much as it should. It was close by the university, 3 dun stories high and 7 dark blue shuttered windows across, with a high-pitched roof snarled by the gabled windows of 2 more stories within it. The doors of Basel were not entries but sentries. Even the grand entranceways of the town hall and the churches were kept closed to intimidate. My master's door was imposing, cut wide but a bit short. He entered it as a perfect fit. His sons, who were taller, bowed to pass. I commonly entered through the back alley and kitchen door where I could hold my head high. It was always blindingly dim inside that door. The hall was dark wood plank floor, darker paneled walls, and darkest beamed ceiling, which all sponged the air clean of light. We stood in the saturating murk, the sons and I, and their homecoming delight was de-lit. As for me, I found it comforting. There was other sight than by light. "Blasted dark in here," Nikolaus said. Yet some ray of our presence had penetrated beyond the hall, and above us there was motion. Starting in some far-off corner, but descending the stairs rapidly, the faint rattle became a jangle, then a clatter, and a glow came bobbing around the corner of the steps, and then appeared to us like a spinning clockwork the lady of the house, the mistress Dorothea. Her black dress and white apron and bonnet blurred in the dusk and from her constant motion. Her candle, in hand at the length of one long arm, was an errant planet far from its sun, the other arm unfurled. "My babies," she said. They braced themselves and were embraced. Nikolaus deftly took the flaming candle as it orbited by, and the arms wrapped themselves around. There would be no escape until she released them, and she did not. They were showered instead by thunderstorms of words in all the languages of motherhood. They bore the soaking willingly and inevitably. No one could be offended by Mistress Dorothea, though one would be overwhelmed. She finally reached, "Come, come, come," in her flow and her arms still around the 2 captives, and with irresistible force impelled them toward the sitting parlor adjacent to the front hall. I stayed behind rather than intrude on their intimate moment, and I was not alone. The light was gone from the steps, but a shadow remained. A boy, or young man, standing where the stairs turned their corner. He had wide open eyes and a mouth closed as if it would never speak, and straight fair hair, and he was still not quite grown to the height of his brothers. This was little Johann, the 3rd brother of the 3, 15 years old and named for his father. "They're both well," I said to him. "Daniel even looks Italian in his silk coat." He did speak.
"Did he tell you how long he'll stay?"
I didn't ask.
"He hasn't told us yet. There are letters for him. From Paris and Russia."
"Russia?"
"I saw them on Papa's desk."
"Is Master Johann coming down?"
"When everyone's had to wait long enough."
I still hesitated. There was no reason for me to remain, but I had a curiosity to watch the master greet his sons.
For all the time I spent in that house, I'd rarely sight him. I pictured him ponderously descending, pompous, portentous, and proud. Just then, behind me, the front door opened. To compare what I'd just envisioned with what I now beheld, if my master was a fresh, firm pumpkin, this was its collapsed, dried-out rind, similar in appearance, but with all the energy drained. We comprehended Cousin Gottlieb. Gottlieb had grown up in Master Johann's household, and was nearly another brother, even having traveled with the family to Holland when Master Johann had held a position there 20 years before. Now at 38, he had his own household. He was actually named Nikolaus for his paternal grandfather, as are many of his relatives, but had forever been called Gottlieb to avoid confusion. Gottlieb was an arid man. I bowed politely. I would not usually engage him in conversation for fear of desiccation. Mistress Dorothea drenched a listener, and Cousin Gottlieb dried him out. Yet I've been fond of him as I am of all the family. It's an odd taste, but well-founded, for they're all worth knowing.
They dared come back, did they?
Gottlieb in his sharp, rasping voice.
They're in there, little Johann answered.
I'd like to know why. And Uncle Johann?
I hear him coming. I had as well, and I knew it was time to be gone. There was more of the family in Basel, far more, but these were my master's closest. Gottlieb was the prime cause for Daniel's departure 2 years before, though the composite cause was Master Johann himself. The tinder in that parlor was stacked high, awaiting the fatherly torch. Rather than walk boldly out the front door, I took the corridor to the kitchen and the back. In the kitchen was a remarkable sight. It was Knipper, the coach driver. In normal times, I'd nod and wave to Knipper and keep my distance. He was explosive. But here he looked dangerous as a wet kitten.
Oh, you, he said, seeing me, and mournfully. You'll help me, won't you?
Sure I will, I said.
It's that.
I'd certainly seen that as quick as I'd seen him. That was a black trunk, big as a man, weighing down the stone floor.
That goose Villy brought it from the coach, and it's not theirs. I should have stayed to be sure he only had the right ones. This one's not meant for here.
Should we carry it back? I asked.
It's too heavy.
Coach drivers were made of old oak roots. I'd never seen one wilted like this. He didn't look able to carry a feather.
But I can't leave it and have the master or his son see I've made fool with the luggage.
The dilemma had poor Knipper pickled.
Run back to the inn and fetch that knave and send him here in his cart.
I'll go, I said. And it was even better reason to miss Master Johann's grand entrance. I could ask the next morning if there'd been warm greetings or hot words. Knipper nearly thanked me to death, he was so relieved. I left Knipper there, with Master Johann's family, and quick-tracked back to the inn. The innkeeper pointed me to the stables without a word when I told him what Knipper was wanting Villy for. The tavern boy was there, hammering some horseshoes into shape, and I rousted him. I asked if he wanted my help, but he didn't. He was ox-strong. That was as well, as by that time the firewood in my master's house was aflame, or already ashes. Ashes to ashes. I was ready to be home, glad to have seen Daniel and Nikolaus, and hungry for supper. It was only a few steps from the Boot and Thorn and the Barefoot Square to my own home. I lived with my mother's mother. She had a tidy house very near St. Leonhard's Church, where she was revered. Her husband was pastor there until his death. My father was also, until he left for the village of Rien soon after my birth. It was hoped that I would follow them to the pulpit, and I would never have regretted if I had. But for good or ill, I've had an even deeper love. So I was here in grandmother's care. Rien was only 5 miles from Basel,
but too far to travel daily. So for these last 5 years, this house has become my home. I have left my father's house to walk among men, placed by him in my grandmother's and Master Johann's care. At supper, after I told grandmother my day and all the doings at my master's house, she gave me a warning. A family should be for peace, Leonhard. There's trouble enough outside the door. Keep a watch on yourself for all you have to do with them. They've always been this way, I said. Every kettle only holds its own measure, and no more. Some day they'll reach that and overflow. And then late, as I laid my head on my pillow, thinking about the day and my master's family, I could hear an overflowing. Not a kettle, but a river. Not the Rhine, but something else, something rising and disturbed. I heard it murmuring and felt its pull, and was pulled by it to sleep. That had been Thursday. The next morning, Friday, I was out early to fetch water. There were three fountains equally near, and I chose the one in the Barefoot Square so I might see Knipper before he was off to Freiburg. The coach was in front of the inn and the passengers were impatient beside it, and the horses restless in their harnesses. But the hole was Knipperless. I was careful to fill the buckets only to their measure and not overflow them. And there was still no driver. I set the buckets on the paving stones, not too close to the horse's edgy hooves, and asked. I had an earful back. Where is he? I'd like to know where is he? I'm told to be up at dawn, and the driver's still sleeping. I was sure he'd soon be by. Knipper kept a schedule as ancient and immutable as the planets. Thursday from Bern to Basel, Friday Basel to Freiburg, and Saturday Freiburg to Strasbourg. Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday he turned his horses back. Inns in the four cities owned his coach and paid him to drive it and deliver his passengers to their front doors. He linked Basel to the French, German, and Swiss lands that surround it. Basel was properly a part of Switzerland, but to its own people it has been a land separate to itself. The keeper of the Boot and Thorn was old Gustavus, and he would be closest of anybody to knowing anything of Knipper. He was standing at the door smoldering. He came out to look close at the coach to see, I thought, that it really had no Knipper. Of course, I was as curious as all the rest, but it was time for me to be on to more chores, and I turned away from the inn. Right at my elbow, I found Daniel. What's the rumpus? He said. Knipper's been lost. Knipper? Oh, the driver? Then where is he? Lost means not knowing where he is. Well, it's you I want anyway, and you're found. I'll be to your kitchen in an hour, I said. Daniel had put his hand on my shoulder in pity. You still labor for him, Leonhard? It's brutes that labor, and not you for the brute. But I do, and I'm glad to. What are you wanting with me? And did you have peaceable words with him last night? Words, not peace. Supper was tolerable, though. But you were lost before I could talk to you, and I want your help with an idea I've been hatching. If it's your idea, then it's cracked. They'll be cracking. Daniel's other hand took hold of my other shoulder, and we were face to face between his arms. It's why I came back to Basel, he said. And there was a hard passion behind his soft smile. It's to do with Uncle Jacob. Uncle Jacob. That was a scorpion's egg he was hatching. I'd heard very little about my master's oldest brother, and he was very firmly not discussed in my master's house. What about him? He's dead. I knew that. I've seen his epitaph. But why is he dead? I had thought much about mortality and so answered, for his sins. I didn't mean it uniquely to old Jacob, as he died before I was born and I never met him, but I'd always been firm on this point, and Daniel would benefit from a reminder. And for a fever too, most likely, and with every hope for resurrection. Your father is the youngest of 10 children,
and he's nearly 60. You should expect to have dead uncles. And you know Master Johann is touchy on Jacob.
Because he has reason to be, and that's why I'm back in Basel, Leonhard. I'm going to look into Uncle Jacob, and the more Brutus doesn't like it, the more I will.
I won't be part of it.
Sure you will. I need your help.
I won't have time this morning.
Tonight?
Tomorrow night, I said, after my lesson.
That'll do. If you can still talk or think after that bruising you go through.
He nodded toward the boot.
I'll be at the inn tomorrow night.
And today's night, I was sure, and many another. I took my leave and my buckets. Away from the barefoot square, I came into the wages street. Paving stones and packed soils carried Basel's traffic, its wheels and shoes. Houses, churches, and structures constrained it. I would often stand at a corner or in a doorway and watch the motion. I would see the good citizens and their horses and carts. I watched university scholars with books under their arms. I saw grand merchants and counselors, the day watch and the night watch. And I would also see reformers in vast robes contending for their faith. In the open squares, I saw Romans with swords and barbarians with pikes, and marching through the gates, I saw knights in chainmail with crusader crosses on their shoulders. In narrow alleys, I saw long corteges, cart after cart on misty mornings, filled by the plague's harvest. In the church cloisters, I saw monks chanting and druids moaning, and Irish friars storytelling, returning the faith of the Roman city to the city of Goths and Vandals. And in archways, I would see angels, and in stairways, saints, and in shadows, shadows. It had always been that I would see invisible things. Then I was to the hay street and my grandmother's house. Even on the most clouded days, the sun always shone on her door. There had always been an anchor that held her firm, and none of the ages in the street outside would ever shake her. So I brought in my water and took in as much of her calm as I could hold, and readied myself for the rest of the day. Next in the mornings, Monday through Friday, after my chores at home, I would present myself at Master Johann's back door. Mistress Dorothea would scoop me into the kitchen. The mistress was the wife of a very great man besides being the sister of the present chief magistrate, and the daughter of a previous. But she was no idle woman. No one in Basel, no matter how great, didn't work. A wealthy family would hire labor, though, and this mistress did. She had a girl, a seamstress's daughter, who helped her with washing and cooking. I did the heavy work. I would stoke the fire and empty the grate and chop wood and fetch water, and most days there would be a floorboard to hammer back or a pot to undent. I've been apprentice carpenter and tinker and smith and cooper. It was mostly the same that I did for my grandmother, but for a grander house and household. I would never see Master Johann these mornings. I would see the others of the family. And it was in years past that in these hours I met the sons and made my friendship with Daniel. The seamstress's daughter was 14 years old, a good laundress and passable cook. But she was flawed. She chattered continually. Worse, she and the mistress together were deafening. The clatter and slap of dishes and ironing and kneading and all else would be bearable. The gossip and pure inanity that congested the air were not. But I bore them anyway. The ridicule I endured from my friends was as hard. Working with women made me a laughingstock with them. And I wasn't paid a copper for any of it. Every morning but Saturday and Sunday I did this. I stopped my ears against Babel. I submitted to the common labor lot of man, passed from Adam to Noah to Greece to Rome to my mistress's kitchen, and I toiled. Yet, like Jacob's for Rachel, my labor seemed fleeting, for my wages were worth so much more than anything I could have been paid in money. Though Daniel scoffed, he knew well what great value I received for my chopping. That Friday morning, I saw no more of Daniel or any of Nikolaus. Little Johann was waiting alone for me in the kitchen, kneading a ball of dough,
I didn't think he talked to anyone else. He'd never liked work, though he did his share. Bread making was an odd hobby for him.
You should have seen us last night, he said.
I shouldn't have. Who was glad for the homecoming? I know the mistress was.
Papa said he was, even despite Daniel's ungrateful, pernicious heart. Daniel said he was glad, too, to see every familiar stone in the city, and even the one where Papa's heart should be. And Nikolaus told the two they weren't father and son, but plain squabbler children. And Gottlieb said he would like very much to know why Daniel had come back at all.
Did Daniel say why he had?
He said it was because he'd missed Gottlieb so dearly. Then I went to my room.
Does it vex the mistress?
She frets and worries, and she doesn't believe they mean what they say.
Do they, Johann? I asked. In truth, he'd know better than they did.
Not all.
And you? He was pounding and shoving his dough.
I'm angry that they're all angry. I want Daniel to go back to Italy.
He said supper was tolerable.
No one talked but Mama. If the rest just stayed quiet, I don't mind them.
I felt badly for him and for his ball of flour. Then the mistress and her maid joined us, and no other talk was possible. When I left her kitchen, the streets were silent as midnight in comparison. My labor ended for the morning. It was time for solemn seriousness. I ran back home. For me, the path between my grandmother's house and my master's was well worn. I ate my quick lunch of bread and cheese and went to my room for my stark transformation. I removed myself from the rough brown garments I preferred and pulled on white shirt and black breeches, then white stockings and black waistcoat, then black and buckle shoes and black justaucorps coat. I had an extra head in my room, a white wood ball on a short stand. It considered life from the top of my dresser. It did this without sight or hearing, which surely improved its ruminations. It wore a white wig and black hat. Each day would I borrow these, transferring them between heads, from the one on my dresser to the one on my shoulders. If any of that wooden block's thoughts transferred also, I was the better for them. The hat wasn't tricorn, which was for men of gravity, but had a wide brim turned up on each side. All in black and white, I was a changed man. I stepped more steadily. I didn't run, or not much. I seemed thoughtful. But despite my best effort, in essence, I would remain myself. Yet observers noticed only appearance, not essence. And so for the next few hours, I appeared a peer to my peers. Later in the afternoon, I made my deconversion. I moved my wig from one block of wood back to the other and hung and folded my blacks and whites. A world where everything was only one or the other would be preferable in many ways. But we lived in a world of browns. Finally, at dinner, I told my grandmother that I would be at the tavern Saturday evening. It's Daniel. He wants my help.
Help to make trouble?
Yes, I said. But I don't know what, so I'll go to find out.
A wise man runs from strife. I have a worry, Leonhard, of what will happen with all that family back in the city.
Blessed are the peacemakers, I said. I have a hope, grandmother, for what could happen. I'd refused Daniel for that Friday evening because I had work to do, work that had to be finished before Saturday afternoon. I planted myself in my room, rooted to my chair, and soon sprouted leaves all over my desk, large leaves of white paper, which the birds of the field roosted in. One particular bird, a goose feather in my hand, was making its nest of inky black scribbles. Saturdays for me began very early. I'd be out for water and breakfasted by sunrise. I had kept this schedule even in the summer when the sun was also an early riser. I'd quickly finish all my other chores.
Grandmother was as strict a taskmistress for me as she was for herself, and only when she was satisfied might I go on to the list of tasks for my other masters that must not be incomplete come Monday. Some weeks I was thorough enough with my time that the list was empty, but if not, I'd fly through it. If I'd been industrious and swift, it was still well before noon. I wouldn't take time for lunch, and a full stomach would muddle me anyway. Instead, I'd settle at my desk and clear my brain to prepare. Saturday was my Sabbath of hardest labor, my rest from idle life. First and crucial, I would take down a book. Leibniz and Newton waited at opposite ends of my shelf, and Descartes in the center. And Fermat and Pascal, Maclaurin and Taylor, de Moivre and L'Hôpital, Hook and Boyle, and many others between. I would have planned this choice through the week and reached the decision in the last waking minutes of the Friday night before, in the dark of my bed. Then, with that book on my desk, I would take out my folio of notes and thoughts from years of Saturdays past. I would set paper and ink and quill beside them all. And finally, I would read. I would pour myself into it, and I would pour it into me. I'd think on every word and every equation of what it means, and what it means more, and what it finally means, and what it means past that, and why and why and why. I only read with a pen in my hand. I'd write to myself, but I could never write enough. And always I would push on. If there had been a shadow on all this, that this was devotion stolen from my devotion to God, it was always beyond me to stop. What else could I do? The hours passed and the book's pages turned slowly, while my own piles of paper grew. I lost my senses, and the world I sensed with them. I lived in an invisible world of logic and theorem more evident to me than ink and paper, more rigid and immutable than the desk and hard chair I'd been sitting on, purer than air, more part of me than my own hands, and unmatched in perfection among all other created things. But then my cock would crow. I've taught myself to hear the clock in St. Leonhard toll three. When it did, I'd blink and firmly close my book. If I didn't immediately, I might not until the bell tolls that three again, which would be far into Sunday morning. But I was never dismayed, because even this pure time would have been only a preamble. Then I'd dress myself in my student finery, buckles to wig, and on this day when no other student in Basel cared much how they look, I cared most. Grandmother would inspect and correct me, and I'd tuck my folio under my arm and set out. I have done this every Saturday for 5 years, and always with trepidation and anticipation together. This Saturday, at the very instant of 3:30, I pulled the bell on the grand doorway in the Munster Square. It was opened by silent Mistress Dorothea, who saw me all other times in peasant brown at her back door with so many words. Now I was to receive the wages I'd earned by my labors of the week. She solemnly ushered me into the dark hall and escorted me up the stairs to a hallway that was smaller, but the same dark, and knocked on a door, so firmly closed that it seemed a wall of stone. I still remembered the first time, when I was 13 and trembling in my shoes, that she knocked, and how nearly I fled at the stony voice that in answer commanded, "Come in!" Now it thrilled me, though I still took stock one last time whether I was completely ready. The mistress opened the door. The room was as dark as the whole house, but a single bright candle burned on the table, which with its two chairs was the only furniture. In one chair was Master Johann, and the other chair was empty. It was for me. For 2 hours I would sit alone under his instruction, and he was the greatest mathematician in the world. My master was a man of substance, not to be trifled with, celebrated across the continent, distinguished in every manner. Basel's first citizen, impressive and remarkable. His eyes, reflected in his son's, were heavy and brooding and pierced like spears. He did not speak often, and his mouth and jaw were hard in his wide face. He wore an old wig in our meetings, and his forehead was very high. He was short and broad compared to others, especially his son's. His hands were somewhat thick with short fingers, yet he had a beautiful script, the equal of any scribe. This physical skill was surprising for a man whose abilities and efforts were mostly centered inside his head. And in his opinion, the whole world was centered about his head. He has lacked any vestige of modesty, sympathy, generosity, leniency, or, sadly, paternity. Master Johann was the professor of mathematics at the university in Basel. He'd had his chair for 20 years. He was the second man to hold that chair. Before him was the chair's founder, his brother Jacob. During the 2 hours that he taught me, I was like little Johann's ball of dough, pounded and stretched and rolled, and finally brought out thoroughly baked, in need of cooling. My head was full and my stomach empty, and I then would stumble, top-heavy, home. I had so much to think about. The papers in my folio, to be read slowly and thoroughly, would give me hours more of thought. They were like a river to be poured down a rabbit hole. I'd be ravenous when I arrived home, and I wouldn't even change out of my black and white. My strict grandmother allowed herself one weekly moment of sympathy. She'd have a table full for me, and I'd wolf it and tell her what I'd learned. For my sake, she had made herself interested in mathematics. My final challenge of the very challenging day was to distill 2 dense gold hours with Master Johann into 20 simple crystal minutes with grandmother. If I could do that, then I had mastered my lesson. Chapter 2. The Boot and Thorn. In my first year in Basel, I was given a book. I was only 13, still apprehensive of my new life, an uprooted sapling fighting to grow new roots in hard soil. Master Johann was a rocky cliff that I grasped, and my roothold in his house was wholly tenuous. I was ignored or mocked in my classes. Then, what a pleasure it was to be befriended. For Daniel, who was a 20-year-old man of note, took note of me. First with cordial greetings, next with amicable conversations, and then with the full shine of his winsome character. Finally, on a morning 3 months after my arrival in Basel, he'd sought me out as I was sweeping his mother's kitchen and tossed a leather volume into my hands. "You say you like books?" he said. "This one's new, just from the printer. See if the ink's dry yet." I didn't know it then, but I'd been given a challenge, and not just a book. It was only later that I learned that particular gleam in Daniel's eye. On that morning, I only saw the pages of Latin and symbols and equations, and my heart leaped. "Thank you." The ink was plenty dry, and I was caught like a fish. A page describing the mathematics of likelihood was open before me, and I read the lines and paragraphs without hope of being able to close it. The words were astonishing. "Hold, hold," Daniel had laughed. "That's terrible stuff there. You'll need help to understand it." "I'll take any help," I said, and meant it. But it seemed plain to me. The Latin was lucid and straight, though wordy, and in just that one page I knew the thesis. Who wrote it? "It was Cousin Gottlieb who made the manuscript and bundled it off to the printer. But he's only the scribe. The author's someone else. Have you heard of Uncle Jacob?" I pulled away from the text and found the title page. The title was Ars Conjectandi, The Art of Conjecturing. The author was professor of Basel, member of the societies of Paris and Berlin, and of my master Johann's family, but not my master. It was Jacob, and below the title was the explanation, Opus Posthumum, published after his death. I don't know, Jacob. Gottlieb took his notes and made a book of them, and that was 10 times the labor of a stonecutter carving Cupid from a boulder. But who was he? Tell me about Jacob. Father's brother, father's teacher, father's master. But don't tell me you can read it. I can, I'd said eagerly. Oh, thank you, Master Daniel. Is it mine? It's yours, he said. And if you can read it so well, then I'll have you explain it to me. Even making his joke, he was still treating me as an equal. I was in awe of him then. This was a young man who'd spent a year in Heidelberg and had returned to Basel to finish his doctorate in medicine, and was the son of my revered master Johann, and I hoped to use his good favor to gain an extra step in my climb of Master Johann's steep ladder. That next Saturday, 5 years ago, I approached my master's house with confidence and Uncle Jacob's book both tucked under my arm. I was taken upstairs and through the door. I still felt very much on trial, having to be perfect in my preparation and understanding each week just to earn my next week's session. So I sat in my chair and set my papers on the table, and then with pride and desperate hope, I placed my offering, the Ars Cognoctandi, on the table for him to notice. My young heart skipped as I waited for my master's hard face and the severe gaze to soften. He took one glance. He recognized the title. Then he transfixed me with the most hostile stare I'd ever experienced. I hadn't known that such animosity existed, and I was its target. He held me on his sword point for an eternity. Then he proceeded with my lesson, never mentioning the book. As soon as I could, I slipped the volume into my lap, out of his sight. He ignored the motion. I endured the 2 hours in agony. I walked home through streets of fire. I ate no dinner but only ran to my room and sobbed my heart out and vowed never to pester Master Johann with my miserable existence again. I didn't keep that vow. I did return and repaired over months the damage done in that one moment. I believed Daniel should have warned me, but he may not have thought to, or that I would be bold to show off my possession. And since then, I have wondered what became of that boulder of notes from which Gottlieb carved his Cognoctandi Cupid. I never have asked Master Johann, of course. Besides stirring his anger at their mention, I was never sure he knew himself where they were. Years later, when he was in Italy, Daniel sent me a copy of his own book, Exercitationes, Mathematical Exercises. His note with it said, More leather for your excellent shelf, Leonhard, and more bait to anger the bear if you didn't learn your lesson before. But I had learned my lesson, and Master Johann never saw that in my hand, and I'd had my first introduction to Uncle Jacob, and most important of all, both the meticulous Cognoctandi and the excellent Exercitationes were gems. So I went forth Saturday night to meet with Daniel, setting my foot on the dark evening streets of Basel. As always, the windows were shuttered, just pins of light pricked out. There was little to fear with the night watch always close. I walked with one of them, he swinging his lantern in his jaw, and I listening for those moments to tales and tall tales of battle and adventure. In the barefoot square, the windows of the church were unshuttered and bright. The inn was lit with darker light. Through its weary door, I left the overworld. Enter the Boot and Thorn. Stiefel und Stachel, tavern primeval, vast beamed of ancient trees, smoked by the unquenchable flame, dark unyielding to light. Inside the door was a passage with no seen end, twisting into distance. Doors and stairs lived in it. And dragons.
On its walls were pictures painted before there was light or color, and rails and molds carved by gnomes. The air was soot and hay and mead. A gray cat with white eyes was named Karen, and was Cerberus. I paid for my passage with a bow and crossed the hallway Styx. On the right was a fissure, and through it the common room. A gaping, howling hearth lit the room, and oil lamps burned with more smoke than flame. Driven up through each table was an iron spike with a candle fixed on it. These were the best illumination in the room. As the evening would pass and each candle breathed its last, and the lamp glasses would blacken and strangle their glow, only the conflagration in the ruddy fireplace would enlighten. The pillars that held the ceiling were not cut by human hands. They, and the ceiling they supported, were really a primordial forest of trunks and branches that grew themselves into that room with its soil floor. Shelves, eye-high, belt-high, high as good thoughts and high as foul plots, ran the circuit of the walls. Tankards packed them. They were wood and clay, little gargoyles who watched in benign grotesquerie over the transacted business. The tables were immovably heavy. They might have been filled or near empty, and it would have appeared the same. The presence of men in the room was heard and sensed, not seen. And to enter the room was to be made part of it, to be made subterranean, to be lit by fire and breathe earthen air. As I stood in the entrance, my vision was blunt, but my ears were sharp, and I quickly knew where Daniel was. He would have preceded me, likely by hours. Only when I came close did I see that his brother Nikolaus was there also. A master from Oxford, a chair of mathematics on a visit once to Master Johann, told me that in England there were coffee rooms for gentlemen in taverns, separate from the commons. Here was no division. Black and white mingled with brown. I wouldn't know which I was meant for if I had to choose. The room, like temptation, was common to all men. I hadn't been noticed, and I paused while Daniel spoke. "There's no word," he was saying to his brother. "Not a breath of a whisper. I was sure there'd be a letter waiting." He had a cup of dice in his hand and tossed them to the table. "Who else could have won the prize? There's not a one who could have beat me." Nikolaus answered him. "It's 100 who could. I'll go to Paris myself and see. I'll have them show me a better piece than what I sent them. I know I won the competition." "Then where's the letter?" "I'll go to Paris and get it." I could see his peeved frustration in the dark as well as I could hear it. He pulled the dice back into his cup. His words interested me, but the dice in his hand did more. The subject of Master Jacob's Ars Cognoctandi was likelihood or chance, what had more recently been named probability. The Cognoctandi presented the rolling of dice as a type of equation, but not one that gave a result. Instead, the mathematics gave possibilities of results. It was an odd prophecy to say with certainty what might happen, but not what would happen. I had wondered at the role of providence in guiding affairs. Did God know how the die would land? "Daniel," I said. "Leonhard!" There was no chance to that. His greeting was certain and exactly as I'd known it would be. He pushed a bench toward me. "Still breathing? Not smothered by your hours in the Holy of Holies?" "I'm breathing. It's the air in here that would smother a man." "Then breathe it deep and listen to me." Now Daniel had his winning smile and friendly ways. All the ire he'd had a moment before was gone. "I've come back to Basel with a goal." The hearth glare fell full on him. It made his grin fiery. "You have a part in it." "Tell me then. I want to know what it is that I want nothing to do with," I said. "Your part's easy enough. It's about Uncle Jacob." "That's poking bears, Daniel." "That's reason enough, itself." "I won't help you, not for that. You know it's a rule that he isn't discussed in the master's house."
I just want to know how Jacob died, that's all. There's nothing wrong with that, is there? If you want to know, just ask.
I am asking.
Ask someone who knows, I said. Your mother.
She'd tell Brutus that I asked.
Ask your cousins, you have plenty.
It'll all get back.
He leaned into my shadow. There are nets laid and webs spun, and I don't want a whisper of anything to reach those ears.
The answer to this seemed evident.
Ask your Uncle Faulkner.
This man was the chief magistrate of Basel and Mistress Dorothea's brother. He's part of no one's net.
But I can't hold him to confidence either. No, you're the only one I can ask.
And I'm the only one who can't answer. I don't know how your Uncle Jacob died.
But you can find the answer. I know you can, Leonhard.
He'd always been this way. Daniel had made friends in every street in Basel, as he pried open the closed doors and searched their shadows. Whoever knew him was fond of him, and whoever knew him well distrusted him as well.
There's something amiss, I said.
There is, he said, and I want to know what it is.
Amiss with you. It's your own uncle and your own family, and I'm the one you're sending into a lion's den.
I can't let the lion know what I want. It has to be you.
He laughed.
You've nothing to fear, old friend. Just throw a few little words, an innocent question. Then listen very close.
Nikolaus had been silent the whole time, and he'd been listening very close.
And are you a part with this? I asked him.
I'm no part.
He's part and parcel, Daniel said. It's his plan anyway.
It isn't, Nikolaus said.
It is, all of it.
Nikolaus is the cunning one, you know.
I said, Uncle Jacob?
And Nikolaus said, Leonhard.
And I said, oh, that's our man.
And Nikolaus said nothing.
I know Jacob's epitaph because I've seen it, and I've heard a few other bits. He was chair of mathematics here, and he died 20 years ago, and you know all that.
I know it, Daniel said.
And I know his mathematics, I said, because of his book that you gave to me.
You only know what dearest cousin Gottlieb put in the book. That's all any of us know.
Except Gottlieb himself, Nikolaus said.
There must be more, I said. But that was not Daniel's interest of the moment.
There's only one thing I want to know, he said, and that's how Jacob died.
That's all?
Nothing more.
Was it in his bed, or in the river, or in between?
In Basel, to die in the river was an evil thing. There was a history to it, of burning and drowning, and Daniel had made a poor joke.
And why do you want to know? Why did you come back to Basel? I asked him.
You answer my question, Leonhard, he said, and he shook his cup. That rattle was the only sound in that room that cut through all the other sound. He tossed the dice and put his hand over the numbers, hiding them.
And I'll answer yours.
Daniel had always been a mule. The more he was pulled on, the less he'd move. I'd only get more perplexity from him, and I'd had enough. Besides, as we had talked there in that underworld, its lord arrived. This was old Gustavus. He was an innkeeper and a blacksmith, and looked both with heavy arms from pounding and a heavy brow from scowling and a black beard like a burned forest. He was old but not aged. He'd hardened like mortar. He came in with a barrel on his shoulder and set it at the counter and then nearly extinguished the lamps with his stare. He fixed on Daniel and drew heavily near.
Good evening, master, he said. An honor for you to visit here.
He spoke cavernously when he spoke. Most often a nod of his head and glint of his eye would get done what he wanted.
Is there anything you require?
A chair at the university, Daniel answered. He had no fear of the man. He'd bought him over many times with the money he'd spent in that room.
Mathematics would do well, though I'd take nearly any of them. He laughed and didn't wait for any answer. But I'd settle for less. What do you have in the stable tonight?
Horses, master.
I thought you would. I might want one for the month.
There'd be one.
Send Villy around with it. I'll look it in the mouth. Gustavus's dark darkened.
Villy's gone with the coach to Freiburg, master. I'll send Fritz.
With the coach? Now Daniel was curious. What would Knipper want with him on the coach?
Villy drove it, master. There was no Knipper.
He never came? I asked. I was not afraid of Gustavus either. Not much.
No.
No master for me. I was in brown. Where'd he get to? Nikolaus asked. And it was odd he'd spent the words.
No place I know, was the answer. I'll send Fritz around with the horse, master.
No need, Daniel said. I'm sure it's fine. I'll want it Monday, about noon. Where are you riding? I asked. Then, as a joke, Russia? Russia? Daniel was authentically amused. Not in an afternoon. It would be a fast horse for that. Paris, then? I asked, still with my joke, and that brought less amusement. Not Paris, either. He turned. That's all, he said to Gustavus. And that was all. Daniel was ready to leave, to return to the living streets, so I was pleased to return with him. We left the eternal dark for the simple black of earthly night, and I turned our conversation toward Italy. This was my interest. I'd always been so curious about the peninsula and all the world beyond Basel, and I even coaxed a few words from Nikolaus on it. He knew the land well. Before he took the chair of law in Bern, he'd been chair of mathematics in Padua, the same chair Daniel now had. Even Gottlieb had held the Galileo chair of astronomy there years before. I wanted to go myself to Venice and Rome and Padua. Someday I'd knipper south. We talked a while before they left toward their home and beds, and I watched them leave. But I stayed in the barefoot square. It has always been the poor whose feet were bare. Their square was named for the church on it, and their church was plain and very large and worth more to them than shoes. It was built in old times by barefoot friars who knew poverty. I went in. It was lit by a few candles, and they brightened more than all the fires in the Boot and Thorn. The ceiling was higher inside than the roof outside, so far above the stones of the floor that the air inside the church was pulled thin by it. It was plain timber, not like the decorated toppings that crown wealthier churches. Two central walls hung from the ceiling a short distance, then split into peaked arches. Long pillars gripped the arches, held up by their tight hold. The pillars reached down to the stone floor and pulled upward on it, so the whole church was supported and lifted by its highest steeple. The floor grasped the crypt, and the crypt was bedded in the rock and soil of the earth, which meant that Basel and the whole planet was held up by the church, and the church by the heavens. If the chains to heaven were cut, the planet would plummet. The heavens would also be freed from the earth then, and would rebound away like a tree branch pulled down and released. But the chains were too strong. They would never break. I sometimes feared, though, that the church might break loose from its foundation and be wrenched into the sky. If it did, I hoped to be in it. It was important of Basel that it was caught like this, held taut between earth and heaven like a knot between ropes. It was part of each, but was not either. One day the city might be pulled fully to one side, and what a sundering that would be. That night, it did not. I sat some minutes on the back bench in a corner, a place where I listened and watched. That night in the barefoot church, I saw winged Michael in holy flame, and slew-foot Lucifer in brimstone, the two of them in dispute, and between them a slab of cold stone. I knew it must be the body of Moses they were contending over, but I couldn't see clearly. Finally, I went back out to the square. The church was many centuries old, and built on centuries more of foundations. But the Boot and Thorn was very old also. These two have faced each other across the square, contending over it. So far, neither had prevailed. Sunday morning was fine and clear as glass. I rose early. I couldn't help it. I walked in thought through Sabbath empty streets to the Munster Square. Master Johann's house was blank and not my destination. I was going to the cathedral itself. Erasmus was buried in the left aisle, and Ecolampadius in the center. But I wanted a different grave and passed by to the cloisters. I knew just where to go. The shaded red stone columns divided the dim walk from the bright grass square. On the white plaster walls, carved stone epitaphs divided the shaded lives of remembered men from those bright living who remember. Soon I stood at a black oval surrounded by a garland wreath of marble, and capped by a globe and two shields. One shield was of 3 7-leaved branches, which was the symbol for Master Johann's family. The other shield was a lion. The engraving was in Latin. At the top of the oval, it named Uncle Jacob. It said of him that he was Mathematicus Incomparabilis. It listed that he was professor of mathematics at Basel University for 18 years, member of the Royal Academy of Paris, and had held many other honors, the Roman ranks of M's, C's, L's, X's, V's, and I's marched through the years of his life, from his Natus through his Augusti Aetatis to his Extinctus 20 years ago. Beneath the large oval was a smaller medallion, a circle. In the circle was an Archimedean spiral of 5 revolutions. Around it was the inscription, Resurgo Eadem Mutata. I arise again the same, though changed. It was a thoughtful statement, and I thought on it, as I had before. It had always bothered me that the spiral it circles, the Archimedean Spira Mudanus, did not match the thought. It was an obscure point, but mathematicians held strong opinions on spirals and their meanings. Finally, I left the cloister, not back to the square, but to the back of the Munster, to the river. This was where I would finish my walk through memories and meanings of lives, lives current, lives recent, and lives before. In the age before Basel, if that age ever was, there was still the Rhine. The bank would have been a high grassy hill steep down to the water. In ancient, ancient times, one Basel was built of rough stone that Roman hands never put there. I'd seen these stones. They were found beneath and pulled from the crypt of the Munster when it was repaired many years ago. 2,000 years ago, the Romans built on the hillside and named their city Basileus, which meant kingship. 1,000 years ago, the Germans ended Rome and took her cities. The people who lived inside the walls today were those German conquerors of Roman conquerors. Of what I knew of conquest, the blood of the ancients and the Romans both still flowed in Basel's veins. Those stones of that first Basel were its only epitaph, but not the only memory of it. Basel's people walked in their streets on the dust of earlier cities, and all the cities were only different ages of the one Basel, and the city had always been within its own walls and not part of the world around. Now the Munster stood on the hill, and a paved court behind the cathedral was high above the water. The old bank was buried beneath its sheer walls. I stood and looked out at the water. The river was high. It hadn't rained more than other Aprils, but the Rhine drained many lands. We saw it pass, but knew not whence it came or where it was going. Somewhere above Basel, there'd been rain. The city had high walls, and very little from outside ever passed them.
but the river always had. I suppose that Uncle Jacob had died closer to his bed than the river. Later, dressed proper, I took my grandmother's hand and promenaded her solemnly to the St. Leonhard's Church. Every Sunday, I'd sit and stand with her for the hymns and readings, and hear the sermon, which was always of great interest to me. I was reminded of watching my own father in his pulpit. A few times each year, I would take my grandmother to Rheen for her to visit my mother, her daughter, and we would sit under my father's Sunday teaching. But those times were rare. It had only been one day before that I'd been immersed in the ocean of mathematics. Now I floated in the air of theology. Both were unseen and undefinable. What were the rules of mathematics? What were those of God? They both existed with or without our knowing. They were universal truths, and our lives were ruled by them absolutely. Could I say that two fish are three? Could I steal a fish and say it was right? Was it two different laws that I would be violating, or were they both one? All the princes and armies in Europe couldn't change a point of either. And both laws divided between right and wrong. Stealing was wrong, and a mathematic error was wrong. The wages of sin were death, but the wages of incorrectly adding were less severe. But still, for each, there was right and wrong, yes and no, good and not good. And just as mathematics was sure and a man could build a house firmly on its calculations, so he could also build his life's house even more firmly on God's law. And I had a feeling now, something that had been with me since I last passed the Ash Gate, that the contention between right and wrong was nearer to the surface than it had been before. I'd never known for what king the Roman city was named, but the kingship of Basel, through all its ages, had always been contested. Afterward, at 2 p.m, we returned to the dining table and dined. It was the only meal of the week that could be described that way, where we were dressed well and sat with pewter plates and a platter with as much food as we wanted. Every other meal was eaten plainly, in thanks and humbleness. On Sunday, we accepted that God was bountiful. Then, through the afternoon, I read to grandmother, that Sunday from Job. Who could wrestle with Leviathan? And who has beheld Behemoth with limbs like bars of iron? The Lord warned Job of them both, and not only Job. I have thought that Leviathan and Behemoth walk Basel's streets. They came sometime long ago, even when the streets were slight paths between straw and wood huts, and the streets only hardened since then. The Sabbath was the day of rest. We both went to bed early. We had done no work on this one day of the week. That was hard for me, but it was proper. The circle of the week returned me to Monday, to beneath Master Johann's roof and Mistress Dorothea's tongue. Leonhard! She was, as always, in her perpetual constant motion. As I entered the kitchen door, she was seated but never still. A chicken waited on her table. A dog's put a hole in the fence and it needs mending. The girl who helps her in the kitchen was somewhere else that morning. I didn't know where, and I would certainly not ask. If I did, I'd be told where, and why not the next day, and because of who, and on. But without the girl, I alone remained for the mistress's bombardment. My sister-in-law's fever is back, and don't put the wood in the settle. She worked too hard before she could become well. She has too many feathers. This was about the chicken she was plucking. I stood for a moment with my load of wood. A fever? It wants washing first. Get a brush. She's always digging and chewing. This was about the wood settle, and then the dog. My brother says to let them run. This was likely about the fever, but might also have been about the dog, or even the chicken. I'll have him warn the council. What Mistress Dorothea would have her brother warn the town council of, unmanaged dogs or contagious fevers, I didn't know yet, but surely not chickens. The threat, though, like everything else concerning her, was not idle.
Magistrate Faulkner's warnings to the City Council of Basel carried great weight. The wood I was carrying was also a great weight. I set it on the floor beside the fireplace and started on the settle, brushing the bark and splinters into the fire, and then scrubbing harder. Are there other fevers in the city? I know of some, she answered, and I knew that I would soon also know. I finished the settle and filled it with wood, and heard the list of my mistress's acquaintances who had any complaint against their health. It was short enough, but very detailed. Your own family's been blessed with good health, I said, remembering the story. Your father lived long, didn't he? 72 years and hell but the last 4. And you returned to Basel from Holland to care for him. I never wished for Holland, she answered. Flat as the sea and nearly the sea. That was a hard move, with a baby and the armies. You moved with armies? I asked, taking bellows to the fire. It, and she, really needed little stoking. Move with armies? What would that be? We moved from them. And I moved from the armies also. And it took you long? 2 months. We were stopped in Strasbourg for half that, waiting for the road to be clear. Clear of the armies, I said. That would be what she was speaking of. Louis of France's armies were fighting in that area at that time, as they had been in most areas at most times. And the baby would have been Nikolaus. 10 years in Groningen, she said, and then Master Johann accused of being a heretic Cartesian. It was scurrilously we were treated, but the master didn't want to leave his chair. He was never Cartesian. I knew Master Johann was the most orthodox of reformed men, if not the most heartfelt. But I didn't believe Cartesian ideas should be dismissed. That philosophy, and Monsieur Descartes himself, had been a study of mine. He was chair of mathematics there, I said. A petty chair next to Basel, she said, but still nothing to throw off like ashes, and the master's honorable above all, and wouldn't let gossip drive him from his work. Then the dean here sent for him to come for a chair. It was my father who wrote to us of the invitation, and also old Master Nikolaus. This would have been Grandfather Nikolaus, Master Johann's father. Both families were wealthy and both magisterial, and none of the deans of the 4 colleges of the university would have ignored their requests. Any university in Europe would have pleaded for Master Johann. They did. When we left Groningen, the provost of Utrecht pursued us 100 miles to lure the master there. But Basel was grandest and kin was dearest, and so he did come, even if it was for the Greek language chair. And so I could be here for father's declining years. It was the Lord's mercy to us all, and I was at his bedside with him and his 2 precious grandchildren. They were his joy and his light, those 2, and he was theirs. We'd come back to the first question of her father's health. Thoughts of chance were still on my mind. He would still have had to win the draw, though, to get the chair. It would still have only been 1 out of 3? Mistress Dorothea had already cocked her head and given me a shrewd glance. The fence is waiting. Mend it, Leonhard, before the dogs make the hole worse, and I'll be grateful to you. It would be time soon to dress black and white, but first while I was in brown, I ran to the Barefoot Square and the Boot and Thorn. Daniel had said he'd be collecting his horse. Day in the common room was like day in heavy forest. Light found its way to the tables and walls like rain in the forest wood, only after touching many distant surfaces first. The fire was low, just smolderers, because it hadn't yet died from the night past, and it must return to life for the night coming. Daytime was the fire's purgatory and a half-life for night dwellers. Karen, the cat, slept with 1 eye. I sat for a while with 2 men I knew, a stonecutter and a book printer, eating noon lunch in the twilight. They were arguing over which had the greatest permanence. "What tears it?" the mason said. "What burns it?" He was an old man and strong, with gray hair streaked dark and white, and the veins in his hands stood out.
Words written in stone, they never fade.
But what's said with them? The printer answered.
You cut one word while I press 1,000.
The printer was younger, but his hair was white with thin black patches like marks, and his skin was brown and leathery.
Which of those 1,000 last? Paper. Here, then gone.
I'll print 1,000 more when they are.
And my one still lasts. There's 100 men buried in the Munster yard, and all that's remembered of them is what I chiseled.
There's 1,000 men whose graves are lost, but they're remembered for their books that I've printed.
If there was anything to remember about me, I said, I'd want it said with both.
There was a man, the printer said, dead more than a decade, but I printed his book and he was remembered again.
But I cut his epitaph and he was never forgotten.
I print the words he said.
I print the words said about him.
I publish his soul.
I chisel his life.
Lithicus, I said to the stonecutter, I know of that man. Was it my master Johann's brother Jacob?
That one, yes.
Did you know him?
I knew him.
And Lieber, I said to the bookbinder, I have that book also, the Ars Conjectandi. Did you read any of it?
That Latin? I don't know any of it.
You carve Latin, I said to Lithicus. Do you remember the words you cut?
I don't know that Latin either, he said,
and he and Lieber shook their heads together, that anyone would. When Daniel did come in, I was still thinking of languages only spoken now by men in black robes. He sat and toyed with his cup of dice, and I thought of the Latin his uncle had written about the arts of chance, and I told him what his mother had told me.
Greek? Daniel said. He'd take the Greek chair? He couldn't crawl in that language.
I think he could crawl, I said of Master Johann, and walk and run.
But he wouldn't sit. He'd never take a chair of Greek. Leave mathematics at Groningen for Greek at Basel? It's not believable.
Your grandfather Faulkner wanted his family close.
I remember that, Daniel said warmly. He was kind and a gentle old man. I'll long remember that.
That's what brought your father back to Basel.
Half a chair and half a family wouldn't add to a whole.
His own father was here.
That's a subtraction, not an addition.
Do you remember your grandfather, Nikolaus?
Not any. He died the year after we were back. Brutus had fled Basel to Holland to be away from him.
Why?
I was never told.
Will you tell your own children why you fled from your father in Basel? I asked.
No.
He laughed again. Because they'll have fled Basel themselves to be away from me.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.